Hey folks, sorry for the delay with this video, had some personal stuff to take care of, but at least we have Christmas just around the corner. Now, I've probably scared you all about shopping, haven't I? Well, to take your mind off of that for a bit, why don't we take a look at a Hideo Kojima game called Zone of the Enders.
And what's this, a Kojima project that doesn't have political warfare or tactical espionage action? Well, okay, we still have the giant robot, so it's sort of Metal Gear-esque. And the title screen and menus for Zone of the Enders look almost note for note like Sons of Liberty's. Kojima may not be the director for the Zone of the Enders games, only acting as the creator and producer this time, but his fingerprints are still all over them, and he knows how to get that top billing. Hell, the opening cutscene for the first game lasts around 5 minutes, and the second game goes on for 8. Yep, things are set in stone so far.
Nowadays, the Zone of the Enders series has a bit of a cult following, with the first game not only spawning a direct sequel, but also a short-lived anime series and an RPG spin-off for the Game Boy Advance that I won't be covering in this video, but maybe some other time. Back in the day though, people only knew Zone of the Enders as that obscure PS2 game that included an early demo of Metal Gear Solid 2, and by the time the HD collection came out, they did it again for Metal Gear Rising when that was brand new, so it was pretty clear that Konami wanted Zone of the Enders to be the next big thing.
I kinda wish this sort of practice happened a little more often with other games, because if done correctly, I think it could be a really effective marketing strategy. You would get a taste of the game you're really waiting for, but perhaps the one you initially bought might take your fancy too. I believe it's a good way to try things out of your comfort zone. It doesn't work all the time, I personally got bored playing Final Fantasy Type-0 after about 6 hours, but with it I also got a glimpse of the highly anticipated Final Fantasy 15, which was a bit better. But let's look at the game that excelled everyone's excitement for Metal Gear Solid 2, the original Zone of the Enders, released in 2001 for the PlayStation 2. Our story takes place in the year 2172, where Mars and Jupiter have been colonized by a man in addition to our beloved Earth, and this military force known as Baram are currently going around attacking an area of Jupiter with their giant mechs to search for two advanced giant mechs called orbital frames. One of the survivors of the attack is this small boy named Leo, who watches as his so-called friends are killed off. I'm indicating air quotes around that because all we've seen them do is insult Leo and just be all around brats, calling him useless and putting the blame on him for their predicament. To which I say, excuse me, I'm not the one in the massive robot here, so keep your early CG mouth shut, little lady. Yeah, I guess I should talk about the CG cutscenes real quick. I get that it's the younger PS2 days, but I think even back then, these were a little rough. It tries to go for the 3D anime look like what the 5th gen Final Fantasies did, but unlike those games, the body movements are very stiff and just generally aren't pleasant to look at, but hoo boy, forget about that. Let's talk about the voice acting. It's not great, an absolute far cry from the Metal Gear games. Leo has this nasally ear-grating voice throughout the whole game, Viola comes across more seductive than intimidating, which makes it really creepy when she's facing Leo, and everyone else just sounds dull or uninterested. I guess I can't blame the actors too much, because while their performances do completely reek, it definitely all comes down to the script. It's amazingly awful. Lines that you've heard a million times in action movies and video games, and not to mention they're corny as hell. I have no idea how the actors read these lines with a straight face, and it has the Metal Gear problem too, with sometimes repeating what the previous character just said. The sound mixing's pretty atrocious at times as well. I had to leave the subtitles on because I couldn't understand a word these characters were saying from the background music.
Viola.
Yes, sir.
Personal feelings intrude. Over and out.
Well, it's time to play.
Okay, sorry, got distracted there. Leo tries to escape the attack but accidentally comes across one of the orbital frames called Jehuti and is assisted by its AI known as Ada. Forced with no other option but to keep pressing on, Leo continues to pilot Jehuti as he's contacted by Earth's military, requesting that he return the orbital frame to them since the original owner died during the attack. Leo's pretty resistant at first, not wanting to kill anybody, but he eventually agrees, and just in time too, because Baram are continuously chasing down Jehuti to take for themselves. That's roughly the gist of Zone of the Enders story. You control Jehuti, you bring Jehuti back, and all's well that ends well. There are a couple of subplots involving Leo's childhood friend Selvice, who isn't an asshole to him, and there's the true intention of Jehuti returning to Earth, but they don't exactly mean much. And the relationship that blooms between Leo and Ada feels incredibly forced. The game's only around 4 hours long, but by the end they talk as if they've known each other for years. If they expect me to buy this after such a short time together, then I'm sorry, but I don't. That may also have something to do with how Ada's incorporated into the game gameplay. She acts as the guide to help you on your path, but I think she finds herself more useful than she really is because, oh my god, does she never stop talking. She's fine when she tells you the objective for each mission, but when she's not doing that, she's constantly pointing out the obvious, like letting you know every single time an enemy's been destroyed, or even if you so much as acquire a health pickup. Imagine if Fee from Zelda Skyward Sword actually spoke instead of just spouting gibberish. Granted, 8 is not quite as bad as Fee, given how short the game is, but it's still irritating beyond belief. The gameplay itself is your basic hack and slasher with honestly not a whole lot of depth to it. You only use one of the face buttons to attack while another uses sub-weapons and the other two are just for flying up and down. When you're far away from the enemy and use the attack button, Jehuti will simply shoot little pellets that slowly chip their health away, but if you're close to the enemy, then you'll instead swing your melee weapon, which does significantly more damage. Assuming you're playing the 360 version, the triggers will also make Jehuti dash, which not only helps evade enemy attacks, but shooting enemies immediately after dashing fires homing lasers, while dashing towards the enemy lets you do a painful jab. Remaining still while holding the dash button charges Jehuti up for either a glowing ball of destruction that can really hurt the bad guys if you have the time for it, or staying close to the enemy does a spin attack that can also dish out a lot of pain, but is good for crowd control as well. Combat unfortunately doesn't get any more complex than this. There aren't new moves to unlock or anything else like that. For some reason there is a leveling system, but I have no idea what it's even for. I didn't notice any difference whatsoever as I went through the game. Thankfully, Zone of the Enders does sort of make up for it by offering a plethora of different sub-weapons. They're not all great, in fact I found about half of them to be entirely useless, but I appreciate the thought of giving us a bunch of toys to play with when we had the ammo for it. You do have to find these sub-weapons first though, which leads to one of the biggest problems I have with the original Zone of the Enders, the exploration. After the opening segment, the game introduces you to a hub world of some kind with various areas, each containing a new mission for you to tackle, and the rare SOS call if you feel like playing the hero. See, the hub world itself isn't the issue I have, it's the amount of backtracking you have to do to finish the game. A large number of the missions will only require you to defeat all of the enemies and rescue some survivors. Pretty simple, but maybe Zone of the Enders will also ask you to visit two locations to shut down energy fields, only to find one of the locations has another shield that you need to switch off by going back to another location and find this inconspicuous broken down orbital frame that you need to remotely control, and then you can shut down the energy field. Perhaps other times you'll need to randomly search previously explored areas for a passcode that unlocks a new subweapon which you need to look in another previously explored area for, just so you can snipe these little weak points or actually stand a chance against one of the bosses that weirdly has music that reminds me of Super Metroid. It's probably the choir. But yeah, Zone of the Enders was not built for exploration. I had to use a guide a couple of times to find out where I was supposed to go because I was wandering aimlessly with no clear direction, especially during that part with the broken orbital frame. Strangely enough though, once you reach the final areas of the game, that's where it decides to have a more linear structure. You just reach from point A to B, that's it. I think the whole game should have been like that, and I don't know why they suddenly decided to do it at the last minute, but it works, I suppose. Challenge was also sort of hit and miss. Most of the time it ranges from a cakewalk to mildly annoying, but a couple of times there were groups of enemies or a certain boss that got under my skin. Not a great deal, but I spent a longer time with them than I should have. It didn't help that they used their shields all the freaking time, which is the main reason I don't use a lot of the sub-weapons. So anytime I was in a tight spot, I just kept doing the dashing stab attack. Yeah, that's kind of all I have to say about Zone of the Enders. It's perfectly fine. It's not amazing, but it's not mediocre. I may just be the wrong demographic for it. There was a lot of inspiration from mecha anime that you'd see in something like the Gundam series. It's not the sort of anime I watch personally. In fact, I'm only a casual anime fan to begin with. I couldn't give two shits about Dragon Ball Z or Naruto, but give me something like Death Note or Black Butler, then I'm all for that. Hell, Chobits is incredibly cheesy, but it's sort of a guilty pleasure for me. I know that mecha anime has its fans, and I'm sure those people will enjoy Zone of the Enders a lot more than I did.
I was curious though to see if its sequel, The Second Runner, improved from the base gameplay. I had a feeling it'd go in one of two ways. It'd either take everything that worked from the first game and expand upon it, or do very little different. After playing it through all the way, I can conclude that Second Runner is kinda stuck in the middle.
It's 2 years after the original game, and on the planet Callisto is a miner named Dingo, and right there is where you can't take this story seriously. There's no way to call your character Dingo without expecting at least one person to snigger at that name. I don't even care what the rest of the story is, because all I'm gonna hear are stereotypical Australians as our leads. But this is a review, so I better carry on. As Dingo mines his way through the planet, he randomly discovers the deserted Jehuti, which Baram once again come to attack and claim their prize, so Dingo has to hop into Jehuti and fight them off, including an AI program of Viola from the first game. Not sure why that was created, but whatever. He ends up being taken in afterwards anyway by the leader of Baram Noman, requesting that Dingo come back to join forces with him like the old days. Dingo ultimately refuses, but not surprisingly ends up shot and left for dead by Noman, which creates the partnership with Ked Marineris, another orbital frame runner who's looking to take down Noman. So she basically turns Jehuti into Dingo's life support, meaning if he leaves at any point, he'll quickly die, allowing Ken to order him around however she sees fit if he doesn't want her to pull the plug. That's one way to force gratitude upon them. And yeah, that's kind of all you need to know with the story. Clear a number of missions to reach Noman and meet some new characters along the way. This isn't deep storytelling in the slightest. There's more going for it than in the original game, like with the return of Leo, a more believable relationship between Dingo and Ken, and most obviously, the presentation. Second Runner has short anime cutscenes to make the plot feel more exciting, and there are also drawn portraits during dialogue exchanges similar to the codec calls in Metal Gear. This suits Zone of the Enders setting a hell of a lot more than with the first game CG cutscenes. They are a little blurry given the old hardware, but I was definitely more engaged overall than with the original. Though dear god, I did not think they could make the acting and writing worse, but they somehow managed it. There is next to no enthusiasm put into these performances, and none of the lines sound natural at all. It's like the actors realize that the script is utter garbage, so every one of them said to themselves that they aren't bringing their A material.
Hey, here we are.
Yeah.
Indeed, I can't believe that you've managed to survive till now.
Well, it's just normal. Wait, I got a communication.
What a troublemaker.
A good match for you.
Stop joking.
Gameplay, on the other hand, is not radically different since the controls are exactly the same, but at the very least, the level variety is a bit better. One mission has you search around a factory to look for a missing survivor, another has you battle an insane amount of enemies with your squad, and there are a ton more boss fights than in the first game. Levels in themselves are a lot more linear than last time, and I don't recall two areas looking the same, so bravo on that. Sub-weapons are back as well and can now be accessed on the fly, which definitely improves the pacing, but sadly you don't get any new ones until near the end of the game. That bummed me out a bit. I definitely could have used the zero-shift sub-weapon way earlier than it let me. Better late than never, I suppose. I also would have liked more combat abilities to Jehuti. It's got a couple of new melee combos added to Second Runner, but I never used them. It's easier to just keep swiping away and push the enemy onto a surface to do extra damage. As common as upgrade and skill tree systems are in adventure games nowadays, I think Second Runner sort of needed one. I could excuse the first Zone of the Enders for not having upgrades because to its credit it did frequently provide new sub-weapons for you to tinker with, but in the sequel I kind of expected maybe a little more to the basic combat. It still functions okay, I just wanted a bit more complexity, that's all. For as much as Second Runner does improve on a few things, I overall felt more frustrated with it than the original. It can be pretty bad sometimes with the amount of enemies it expects you to handle, and there were some missions that completely aggravated me, either because I kept getting hurt with no invincibility frames whatsoever, or they just go on for way too long. This train segment took a while for me to conquer because of having to deal with numerous enemies getting up close and personal and turrets attacking me on all the carriages. And this escort mission with Ken's broken orbital frame is the worst of its kind. A never-ending swarm of persistent enemies that constantly home in on you and your escort, draining down a ridiculous amount of health in a short time. And you've got Ken slowly falling into a pit of lava unless you grab her, so you've got to keep a close eye on her too. No joke, it took me 35 minutes to clear this hellish mission. For God's sake, look how fast her health depletes if you're late. That's a perfect visual summary of this horrible level, and wouldn't you know it, the next one sucks too. Having to follow specific directions from Ken if you don't want your ass blown up after two hits. This is what I expected to see in a mecha anime game. Woo, fun times. Man, some of the bosses are incredibly annoying as well. Leo takes freaking forever to beat with his Vic Viper, which I'm not sure if that's supposed to be a Gradius reference. It does turn into a ship, and the front shield looks very similar, but I can't confirm that. This final battle with the AI Viola was irritating for needing to parry so much until she flinches back, and you don't have long to grab her and deactivate the orbital frame, and both phases of the final boss were just a tiresome chasing game. I have no idea how these and certain stages were even considered passable. They aren't fun, they're time consuming, and they put me in a bad mood. To sum up Second Runner as a whole, it's unfortunate that I only considered this a marginally better sequel as opposed to an outstanding one. Neither of the Zone of the Enders games are bad, I just personally find them somewhat uninteresting story-wise, and a number of the missions flat out piss me off. I can sort of see why the small amount of fans like it, but to me, I wasn't entertained enough to play through them again and again to try and understand the complicated narratives. That's what I play Metal Gear for, and somewhat Kingdom Hearts. It's not really fair to compare Zone of the Enders to the Metal Gear games, however, because they're entirely different genres. I don't know, I think some of you may like it if mecha anime is your cup of tea, but I'd personally go with the second game. The HD collection's available for dirt cheap on the 360 and PlayStation 3, and Second Runner also became available on the PS4 just recently, though not the first game for some reason, and I couldn't tell you why.
Another Kojima game down, and I'm sorry to those of you that really do like Zone of the Enders. It's good for some quick entertainment, entertainment, but not much else for me personally. I'll see you all in the next video anyway, and come to think of it, I'm sure there was another Kojima game I was supposed to talk about. Ow! Oh, fuck! Ow! Oh, no, that was fine!
Was it?
Yes, that was fine! Damn it!
Pass your face!
Come to think of it, I'm sure there was another Kojima game I was supposed to talk about. Oh, you were late there. Oh. No, you were late.
I see.